Our next speaker is Dr. Jaspreet Sukhija, Assistant Professor of the PGI Chandigarh, Consultant Pediatric and Neuro-Ophthalm, President of Chandigarh Ophthalmic Society, and he is going to guide us through his talk on understanding and interpreting the neuro-ophthalmic angle in visual fields. On to your interesting talk, Dr. Jaspreet.
Thank you, Dr. Chitra, for this opportunity. And we've had such great lucid presentations on glaucoma. And we'll just shift on to something different, a little neuro-ophthalmology, where probably you will like to have a look at the gross picture rather than seeing each point. So I would be discussing about how to interpret this and how to go about localizing the lesion. So what is the importance of visual field in neuro-ophthalmology? The basic thing is that you can easily localize the lesion. Sometimes, yes, if there are pattern variation in patterns, yes, you would have to see the picture as a whole. But for this, a good knowledge of the visual pathway is very important, because what happens is field effects do conform to specific patterns. Now, what happens, even sometimes with negative imaging, the visual field pattern could give a clue, like maybe in the case of chiasmitis, when there is no enhancement, or sometimes when the lesions are difficult to identify in optic tract and geniculate body lesions, metabolic lesions affecting the cortex, which might not have anything on the imaging, but give a clue on the visual field analysis. So these are some of the regions when your visual field really becomes helpful. The importance here is the easier part here is how it localizes lesion is that our visual system functionally gets divided vertically at the chiasma, and it is horizontal before that. So all pre-chiasmal lesions, mainly most of them would have a horizontal defect, whereas those affecting the chiasma and retrochiasmal would have a vertical separation. And progressive visual field defects are unlikely due to neurological causes. I don't say it in every case, but for follow-up, you do visual fields, but you can say progression is unlikely, because you would be able to, you can say, topographically localize the lesion and probably manage the patient. So just coming to this field effect when you start with, I mean, just this is a blind spot here, and this is a lesion in the inferior field, probably just a non-localizing focal defects. So this does not follow any, you can say, any pattern of the nerve fiber layer bundle defects. So it really becomes difficult in such cases. It's basically the usefulness decreases about what you are dealing with. But when you have neuro-ophthalmologic defects, it really follows, it follows a pattern. Now this lesion here could be just because of some retinal lesions in the superior part of the retina, which is superior to the disc. So one has to look at the retina also before basically interpreting all these fields. So the anatomy is very important in neuro-ophthalmology, because as I said, localizing the visual fields help in localizing where the lesion is. So what happens is our optic nerve basically has both nasal and temporal fibers from one eye. And these fibers, the nasal fibers, then decussate at the optic chiasma and carry on with the temporal fibers of the contralateral eye. This is as an optic tract, and then reach the lateral geniculate body. And from there you have the optic radiations, which are going to the parietal and the occipital lobes. So all these lesions anywhere happening will give a particular defect. From here onwards, posteriorly, you would have a vertical separation, because you would have a nasal and a temporal of one eye. Whereas in front of these, because it's just a single optic nerve, probably it obeys the horizontal meridian. So these field effects I would be just discussing in detail. The idea was to have to know the brief anatomy, because the lesions in the subsequent slide would be discussed according to the to these pathways. Potential nasal field effects, if we see, they are very rare in neuro-ophthalmology, and they are without hemianopic character are likely glaucomatous. They could be optic nerve drusen as well. If you have an insidious bilateral central or centrosecal defect, that's the hallmark of intrinsic optic nerve disease, which could be hereditary, nutritional, or toxic. But yes, if it is unilateral, in neuro-ophthalmology, you always have to check the opposite field. Always have a look at the opposite field. You might be missing a temporal defect. So coming on to the specific topographic pattern, after understanding the anatomy of the visual pathway, coming on to how to interpret these, a common lesion which is discussed in one of in the previous presentation is the enlarged blind spot. So what a neuro-ophthalmologist would see is, you can see a papilledema. So that is one of the common causes of having an enlarged blind spot. That is one of the, you can say, common field effects in patients with optic disc edema. But remember, this blind spot is basically because of a relative scotoma, which is because of stretching of the peripapillary retina. So anything which causes a, you can say, a damage to the peripapillary area, so would sometimes cause an increase in the blind spot, which could be because of sometimes the photoreceptor lesions, but they would have other clinical problems as photopsia, or it could be clinically visible on the in the 90D examination. Neuro-ophthalmology, yes, papillary edema is one of the most important causes. Then how do you differentiate if it's optic neuritis? You can have a MOG-associated optic neuritis where you have disc edema, but then you have an RAPD, a pain, and a collavion. So every visual field examination, what you see here, this enlarged blind spot, has to be correlated clinically with the ocular examination also. Then the other thing is, commonly what we see is in optic nerve disorders, and sometimes in bilateral optic nerve disorders as well, central or centrosecal scotoma. Usually it is said if you have a unilateral centrosecal scotoma, probably just see for maculopathy first, because there the most common cause in such cases with a low vision visual acuity would be a maculopathy. But in case of bilateral causes, you can see here a secocentral scotoma on the grayscale here, and on the pattern deviation as well here, is basically because of this defect here in the papillomacular bundle. So centrosecal scotoma or the central scotoma is because of this small fiber area here between the macula and the optic disc, and which leads to what we call a centrosecal scotoma. It's bilateral. The causes are nutritional. It could be toxic. It could be hereditary, like maybe a Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy. So this gives a clue as to what you're dealing with. So coming on to the arcuate or the altitudinal scotomas and the nasal step, probably what happens here is these arcuate scotomas, as we discussed, as you see so many in probably the glaucoma patients, common finding is the arcuate scotoma, and then you have inferior altitudinal field effect as well, which is seen in the ischemic neuropathies. So this is basically because of this superior arcuate fibers here above the disc, which are involved, which is lead on to the inferior altitudinal field effects. So anterior ischemic optic neuropathy is one of the most common causes of an altitudinal field defect. You could have it in papillary edema as well. You could have optic neuritis can give rise to just any kind of field effect, or you could have a drusen of the optic nerve head. And one interesting thing is that temporal wedge scotoma, sometimes you see that's because of a congenital dysplastic optic disc. Basically, the fibers here, you can say the nasal fibers here, are defective. So these are some of the findings which can help in localizing the lesion. Probably in pre-chiasmatic, probably that not much of a help, but post-chiasmatic or the chiasma, the pattern of the visual field effect is very important. So coming to the chiasmatic lesions, chiasmal lesions, which are the most common, is a bitemporal field effect. So these are the lesions which are involving the optic chiasma. So bitemporal is because of these crossing fibers, the nasal crossing fibers, you will have a temporal defect in one eye and a temporal in the other eye. So this is most commonly seen in lesions of the pituitary, like pituitary adenoma. Now the pituitary adenoma grows from below. So if it compresses from below, probably the initial defect would be a superior bitemporal. Rather than having a complete bitemporal, it would be superior. And in case of lesions which are compressing it from above, like craniopharyngioma, you would have an inferior bitemporal to start with. Then the other thing I was talking about is chiasmitis. So if you have patients because of so much tuberculosis in our country, and people on anti-ATT, ethambutol is one of the important causes of optic neuropathy. And optic neuropathy, you can say a bilateral central scotoma, as is seen here. But what this patient has was, of course, if you see the grayscale, he has a central scotoma. And of course, you can see here a temporal defect, a bitemporal defect. On imaging also, we could see some enhancement in the chiasma. The vision was quite low because of this central scotoma what the patient had. And after some time, probably this the chiasmitis resolved, but the patient still had a central scotoma just following this patient. So these patterns sometimes give you a clue as to what is the inciting cause and where the lesion could be. Okay. So the other thing is that some rare causes are like the unilateral temporal hemianopia, which of course because of it's a rare thing to have a unilateral temporal hemianopia affecting just the nasal fibers of the posterior optic nerve. But more common is when you have the junction involved here, you could have a temporal hemianopia in one eye, and you can have a you can see a superior temporal scotoma in the other eye, or you could have a centrosecal in one eye, and you can have a superior temporal in the other eye, which is known as a junctional scotoma. So in coming to retrochiasmal, that's homonymous hemianopias, I mean, you can have a, if it's a congress means shape and size is almost a similar. So this is a congress homonymous hemianopia, where you know that the lesions are posterior, that is the optic radiation or in the cortex. If it's an incongruous, probably where the lesions are probably in the optic tract, that's anteriorly. And in the and once you reach the occipital lobe, probably congruous defects are more common here, like a pie in the sky, which is seen in patients with temporal lobe lesions. So a pie in the sky is also sometimes, so it will involve the whole quadrant, but to start with, it involves this vertical meridian and gradually going on to the periphery. So if you have a complete defect, that means a complete defect, probably you cannot locate the lesion, but an incongruous or an incomplete defect, probably we can refine our locations. So just some pictures, these are homonymous paracentral scotomas, where you find that the lesion is in the posterior occipital cortex. So, and in the macular sparing homonymous hemianopia, the lesion is in the anterior occipital cortex, so it's sparing the macula. And an hourglass pattern is sometimes seen in patients with lateral genicular body lesions. Why is it sparing here? Because probably the anterior choroidal artery supplies some layers, where the lateral is supplying the other layers. So this is a very rare thing, but if you have patterns like this, like homonymous hemianopias, probably you can just identify the lesion, and probably in imaging you can help identify. In even imaging you can have a clue probably what you're looking for. Then you have constricted visual fields. It was discussed here, seen other conditions as well as in optic neuropathy. You have a difference in threshold sensitivity in this nasal area here, which is evident on this deviation plot here. So that is just to give you a clue. Probably it's just a double arcuate scotoma going above and below. And if you have a lesion in the bilateral visual cortex, how do you identify it's a, if it's a bilateral homonymous hemianopia and the cause in the visual cortex? One of the clues is that it's an, you can say the images are superimposable. You can see here it's superimposed. So that gives a clue that basically you're dealing with something in the visual cortex. The second thing is this vertical threshold sensitivity. If you see here this dark area, and if you see here it's a lighter. So there's a difference in sensitivity. So that gives a clue basically that there is something going on in the visual cortex. Lastly, just to coming, temporal crescent, again, not that common, very difficult to plot on the 30 degrees field, probably because it's like a retrochiasmal lesion, which does not, it's monocular. So one retrochiasmal lesion, which is monocular, is a temporal crescent because of the, and most anterior part of the occipital lobe being affected. So sometimes if this happens, if you can plot it on the confrontation as well, you should be careful that yes, this is some anterior part of the visual field and occipital cortex what you're dealing, and it's a monocular event. So just coming summarizing this, show you what the patterns of visual field loss are and where could the topographic location be. This is a whole table which will give you a clue what type of a loss it is and where could the lesion be. But yes, it's not just the visual field, it's also something which you have to see clinically. You have to examine the optic disc, you have to examine the pupils, you have to examine color vision, a lot of things which have to be done. So a stepwise approach to neuro-ophthalmologic field interpretation would be as in the glaucometer's field, it would be like determining if it's normal or abnormal, because even if the indices look normal, look at the grayscale here, a vertical steps in the superior field can be missed. It could be a sign of early bitemporal hemianopia. If the fields are abnormal, check if the testing conditions were appropriate, like has been previously discussed. Determine one eye or both eyes, that will give a clue if you are dealing with a pre-chiasmal lesion or it's a post-chiasmal lesion. Then take a global view, identify specific areas or inferior field, a nasal or temporal, see where the greatest, just concluding, last two points. Check for specific size, shape, patterns, does it obey meridian, is it congruous, is it pointing to the blind spot, is it symmetric or asymmetric? But remember, it's not the just the visual field, always use it in conjunction with the clinical afferent information to narrow down a diagnosis. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Jaspreet. That was a brilliant talk, a great summary. I'm going to go for a very simple question. Dr. Murli, are you there?
Yes, madam. Yes, yeah, yes.
Now, if a patient has a ethambutol toxicity and it shows a central or a centrosecal scotoma. So what would be the line of action you would take? I want to know.
You want me to answer the question, madam?
Yes.
Yeah, madam, that's a very important thing. The problem is that the RNTCP now has increased the days of ethambutol. From earlier, it was 2+4. That is, we had 4 medications, INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol for the first 2 months. And then you had INH and rifampicin for the next 4 months. And the earlier, the DOT scheme or the RNTCP had it thrice a week. That was when they used to get the antitubercular drugs. Now, with the emergence of multidrug resistant TB and extremely drug-resistant TB, the program has modified the schedule based on WHO recommendations so that the patients get the antituberculous drugs daily. And it is now 4 drugs, INH, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol for the first 2 months. And then for the next 4 months, only pyrazinamide is off. So you get ethambutol all along for 6 months, sometimes for as long as 9 months. And the dosage of ethambutol is now based on weight. So again, patients at the end of the weight, sometimes they get dosage as high as 20 to 25 milligram per kg body weight. So the incidence of toxicity has gone up to 10 to 16%. This is what we need to be aware. And the worst part is that ophthalmologists, now with Dr. Rohit Saxena's initiative, they have also been made part of the RNTCP advisory board. But otherwise, when this revision was formulated, we were not part of this thing. And many physician and the healthcare workers, ASHA workers, they were not even aware that this was an issue. And patients, even we have seen quite a few patients where patients didn't volunteer the history of ethambutol intake. But when we asked, they said, yes, they were on TB for pot spine or for pulmonary tuberculosis for such and such date. So the important key here is to identify it, early. Once the visual loss begins and it becomes severe, only 30 to 50% would recover. And the recovery spans as long as 6 to 9 months. So the primary treatment here is to stop ethambutol. You can give some supplements containing zinc and copper because that is based on a putative mode of action. But the primary thing is to recognize and stop ethambutol forthwith. And the key thing here is INH is also toxic to the optic nerve. So if there's no recovery over 4 to 6 weeks, then INH has to stop too. And in case there is some disc margin blurring, then INH is stopped from the very beginning. Linezolid, which is used in extremely drug-resistant tuberculosis, that also is optic nerve toxic. So in case you are juggling with the treatment regime, we have to take a balance. As Dr. Jaspreet also said, CNS tuberculosis is an important aspect of this. And so we have to coordinate with an infectious disease specialist so that the patient is not taken off care and he continues to receive his ATT at the same time, salvaging him from optic nerve toxicity. Recovery is slow, actually, taking anywhere from 3 to 9 months and may not be complete also.
Thanks, Murli. There could have been more questions, but let's finish our two speakers and we could come back to this topic, which has some